Is there really a study that's suggesting new guidelines for opioid prescriptions?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
Everybody, and welcome to Medical History Mysteries. I'm Dr. Pam Maragliano-Muniz with the one and only Dr. Tom Viola. How are you?
I'm so good when I'm in the same room with you, Pam, even if we're not in the same room. How about that?
Oh my gosh, same here. I'm so glad we're finally back doing this again. I know our schedules have been really tough, and guys, we've certainly missed you, but we have an interesting topic today. So there's a new study that's suggesting new guidelines, like newer than the new guidelines for opioid prescriptions. Could you please enlighten us?
I certainly will. So this was an article that was published, as a matter of fact, on my screen, I'm looking at it at the same time, published in January this year, January 11th, right? That said that we're going to look at a whole basket of studies and that have been conducted on how we best control dental pain and find out once and for all, although we've heard this before, once and for all, what is the right analgesic to use to best manage dental pain. Now, you know, Pam, just because we're in the middle of an opioid epidemic and we're trying to curb the use of opioids, we're trying to also at the same time alleviate pain as quickly as possible, because we know pain is a deterrent. It's a reason not to go see your dentist and not to go see your hygienist, right? So we want to try to make pain not this obstacle, but rather treat pain effectively and efficiently, get people out of pain as fast as possible so they won't look at it as an obstruction or as an obstacle to come see you. So back and forth we go. And I call this the pendulum. And you know, I've said this many times about aspirin. I've said this many times about cannabis. You know, the guidelines go back and forth like a pendulum. But this latest study really was controversial, because it actually says that one of the better things we can use to treat pain is an opioid.
What?
Absolutely. So let me give you the information, right? So we've got it's a great study out of McMaster University on the Faculty of Health Sciences. And it was published, as I said, January of this year. It used systematic review, right? And network meta-analyses to review the comparative effectiveness of known pharmacologic interventions. Now, to preface that a little bit, we'll say that they specifically focused on simple and surgical tooth extractions and or the pain associated with pulpitis. Those were the two criteria they used in determining what's the best choice of analgesic. Now, ordinarily, as the pharmacist and the pharmacologist, I will tell you, and you know I've said this to you before, Pam, studies come and go. And I always wait to see, you know, from anecdotal to clinical, what's the comparison? Okay, but this one was special, because this study was conducted to inform the 2022 evidence-based clinical guidelines for the ADA's Council on Scientific Affairs, which I've been blessed enough to be a part of, as well as the Science and Research Institute, with contributions as well, from what I understand, from the University of Pittsburgh and University of Pennsylvania. So we're talking about people who really are on top of this pain management, who published study after study and really have helped guide us in dentistry. You know, people I look up to. And this study was supposed to sort of, you know, give them guidance. Well, what did the study say? The study said that these are your four options that are the best ways to control pain. First was something that we're all familiar with, ibuprofen plus acetaminophen. But not in the strengths that a lot of my colleagues, a lot of my, you know, mentors, and even me have said, you know, based on what I've heard from your colleagues out there, on what works best. The study said that ibuprofen should be dosed at 200 to 400 milligrams, where in the past we've always heard 400 to 600 milligrams or even 800 milligrams, plus acetaminophen in the 500 to 1,000 milligram range. Now, we've always tried to come down from the acetaminophen, because we know that people, if you took this four times a day, for example, that would mean what? That would mean, okay, 1,000 milligrams, four times a day is 4,000 milligrams. You're at the upper limit. Well, what if you decide to take Excedrin or NyQuil or DayQuil? Those all contain acetaminophens, and now you're over the 4,000 milligram limit for the day. But that's what one of their chief recommendations was. The next one was even more controversial. Again, this is my opinion. It may not be very controversial to some, but it did say what? The next best choice was oxycodone 10 milligram and acetaminophen 650. Why is that controversial? Well, because we're trying to avoid the use of opioids, aren't we? Wasn't that one of the whole things that we've been trying to find a way away from opioids? Now, if you've heard me lecture, if you're one of the people who are listening have heard me lecture, you know I've been one of the first to say there's always a place for opioids in dentistry. But as an adjunct to ibuprofen and acetaminophen. Now, if I got this wrong, then, send a comment and let me know. But I'm looking at the study and it clearly says these are your options, okay? So it didn't say take the oxycodone and acetaminophen along with. It said these are your four choices, okay? So why is that a problem for me? Putting aside the issue with the opioid epidemic in the U.S., my problem with this is very simple. There's nothing anti-inflammatory about either oxycodone or acetaminophen. And we all know that dental pain is acute inflammatory pain. All right, next option, ibuprofen 400 milligrams. That's it. No acetaminophen. Hey, ibuprofen is a great anti-inflammatory, but doesn't really work that well as an analgesic. Yet it's hard for me to argue with this because it's based on this analysis that they conducted of all this different research. The last one, well, not as controversial as maybe the second one, but still a little bit, naproxen or Aleve, right, 400 to 440 milligrams as a dose. Now, again, the American Dental Association, and I have a lot of respect for them, have said what? You should be using Aleve to treat dental pain. But a lot of the push for that has been in place of opioids, not necessarily in place of ibuprofen, although you could make the argument. But this is a standalone dose of just naproxen without the acetaminophen. Will it work? According to the data, it does.
Okay, this is interesting because I don't know. I feel like I'm a list person and I like lists that are like, first choice, second choice, third choice, fourth choice,
yes,
or least to most, something like that. And I feel like this list kind of goes a little bit all over the place. Is there any explanation to why that is the case?
I'm actually scrolling through the study right now because I want to make sure I get it right for all of the people out there. And this is what they recommend as, now they do say, hold on, this is what they do say. I'm going to bring it right up. So they say that there needs to be more research done on some of the more tried and true things that we used to use that were not part of this specific systematic review. So what would those things be? Ibuprofen, 200 milligrams, plus hydrocodone, 5 milligrams. Now, for those of you that are more seasoned clinicians like me, you would remember that as the old Vicoprofen product that was available for some time. Then the next thing they recommend is more research on hydrocodone 5 milligram and acetaminophen 300 milligram to 325, which a lot of us probably still prescribe as Vicodin or Norco or, Lorset or Lortab. And then they said tramadol 37.5 milligrams with acetaminophen 325, which a lot of us would recommend as or recognize as Ultraset. So they did not include those, but they did say further research should be done on those things. But I'm going to read it right out. Ready? Based on moderate and high certainty evidence in individuals undergoing surgical tooth extractions, the interventions classified as the most effective for pain relief were, and they listed it just as I did. So all I can say is it's a little weird. One thing I also found was it said oxycodone 5 milligrams or codeine 60 milligrams or tramadol plus acetaminophen in the dose we just recommended were no better than placebo. It's just shocking. That's all I could say. But I think one of the reasons you and I do this, Pam, is because if you're the average, lay person out there and you found a study like this, you might go to your dentist and say, this is what the study said. This is what I want. At the same time, if you're a general practitioner in dentistry out there, I can imagine this is overwhelming for you because you hear, you know, talking heads like me say, use this. And then you read a study that says, use this. And it doesn't really match up.
Yeah, I will say this is medical history mysteries. And we try to uncover, you know, what could be confusing. And I think we almost made it worse. So there's research, and you got to applaud research. And I'm a big supporter for research, but taking research and applying it practically. So I would say at this point that still the judicious use of opioids is still what we should do. And that should probably still be a last resort. And if you are going to prescribe an opioid, to make sure that you refer to your prescription monitoring program first. Absolutely. And obviously consider a non-opioid solution as a primary suggestion. Would you agree with that?
I think if we're going to solve this medical history mystery, then let's do exactly what you just said. Plus, let's do this. If you're out there as a practitioner in dentistry and you're using a combination of ibuprofen and acetaminophen or whatever that works, keep doing it. Because what, in my opinion, if it's working for you, that's all the evidence and research anybody's going to need. Again, should we be more judicious in our use of opioids? Absolutely. But again, if you're using a combination of ibuprofen and acetaminophen that works for you, keep using it.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Correct. Yes.
All right. Well, thank you for sharing this study. Thank you for helping us understand, because I think it would be very confusing for those who stumble upon it. And there is more research that is warranted, and we're here to share it with you when it comes out. So we will certainly see you next time for Medical History Mysteries.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.